Okay, guys, in celebration of our Superhero September, our question of the week
the
is...
The first time we've ever planned anything ahead, just letting you guys know.
No, we did, what was the other month?
Nope.
The Monster, never yeah, worked. We did the Monster May.
Yeah, but so... I'm pretty sure the last one was posted in June. I'm like 99% sure.
That's possible. If you could have any superpower, what would it be?
Any superpower?
Any superpower.
Dude, I got this one.
All right, go DeHart.
Telekinesis. As long as there's no limit to it, you can do anything.
Yeah, pretty much.
You can fly, you can stop bullets.
But if somebody shoots you in the face while you're asleep, you can't do shit about it.
You can't set up a telepathic bubble around you and force
it. Yeah, but it goes away when you're asleep because you
don't know that though, man.
Yeah, or I believe
so that would be
that,
your ability.
I believe if
telekinetic bubbles will protect you from being shot in the face.
That's
while
just
you sleep.
One of the things that I would work on with my telepathy.
Yeah, and I think if you're that strong of a telepath, then you would just...
I mean, telekinesis.
Yeah, if you were that strong of a telekinetic, then you would be able to know whether somebody's getting ready to fuck with you in your sleep.
Probably.
No, those are two different things. Telekinesis and telepathy are not the same thing.
I know that, but I still think you would be able to know.
My superpower is way better. I would have the ability to completely stop time and just move around inside of a stopped universe.
So you're just an episode of The Twilight Zone.
Yeah, but nobody could ever fuck with me, ever.
Have you ever seen that episode? The guy,
no, I haven't.
The guy has a watch that allows that to happen, and then he fucking breaks it, so he's stuck in that time forever without being, you know, fucked with, I guess.
Yeah.
So somebody might like it.
First you see, but it wouldn't be a shitty watch, that it would just be a superpower that I innately have.
Yeah.
And it wouldn't be able to break, obviously.
So kind of like a Scarlet Witch type, like, reality-changing thing. But
yeah. Except for not erasing all the existence of mutants.
Yeah. I'm just going to have to go with straight teleportation. I don't even need anything big. Just allow me not to have to sit in fucking Louisville traffic.
I thought you were going
to
say shit.
No,
shit.
Yeah, that's
it. Teleport your poop into the bathroom. Yeah.
Something to just allow me not to sit in shitty bridge traffic for 2.5 hours of fucking trip.
You're not asking for much. Just a little teleportation thing.
Yeah, just... I don't even care.
Like that one time whenever you said you would love to have transportation technology. It's like, oh yeah, you have that with your legs.
Yeah, and no, I remember we did one of these, and one of my shitty superpowers was being able to find the remote and keys and like random things that I lose on any given
at
day.
At any given time. Yeah. Just pointless telepathy.
How about the power not to lose them in the first place?
No, not that power.
How about you, Ben?
Well, I think definitely I've always really loved Magneto's power, and also because he's totally overpowered, Dr. Manhattan, the power to manipulate matter at an atomic level.
Yeah. So kind of like easily...
You just want to be omnipotent.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Easily just God, the most badass
See, power going, ever. Going back to the traffic thing, I always wish I had Magneto's power.
Just throwing cars off the fucking... That would be exactly what would happen.
Bye, everybody on the bridge.
It's like, oh, you don't know how to signal? Well, now I'm going to crush your SUV, and you were going to die on the inside of it. How do you like that?
Oddly enough, that's also Ernest P. Worrell's power. And Ernest goes to jail.
Oh.
Oh, yeah, it is. Oh, well, his evil twin. Yeah. Like, yeah.
Awful.
Oh, I forgot all about that.
Yeah. He plays two roles in that movie. That's
a double duty.
Very Eddie Murphy of him.
Yeah.
Okay, so once again, welcome to Superhero September. Yay. And... I'm one of your hosts, Stephen the Rose Rosenberg.
Phil the Kill Collins.
Andy Hart.
And we have a special guest for you here today, our friend Ben.
Hey, everybody. My name is Ben. I'm a special guest here today.
You are. You like long walks on the beach.
I do.
Coloring pictures.
I think everyone pretty much likes
if the weather is,
the
is right for a walk on the beach, I would not say no.
Coloring pictures of mystical creatures.
Unicorns.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Gnomes.
Mostly unicorns.
Yeah.
Gnomes riding unicorns. Basically, for this month... We have decided to do movies about superheroes that really aren't that super.
They suck at being superheroes. That's the theme. And it, we got a
it really wasn't
several
intended
really
to be
good
ones. But that's just how our minds work.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, we could do just Captain America movies or something.
Well,
that's how many Marvel movies there are.
I think there's only like four, though.
Yeah, and
that's if you count the old ones by Albert Pyun.
And that really shitty
David
1990
Hasselhoff
one. No, that was Nick Fury.
Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D.
But there is a really shitty one in 1990 where he has fake ears.
Albert Pyun.
Yeah.
Ears, no reason.
Yeah, not at all. So the first two movies we're starting off with this month are The Rocketeer. and The Shadow.
Oh my god.
So, which are both from the 90s.
We should really just never go back to the 90s. We should stay out of the 90s.
Forever.
For the rest of the time.
Unless we're just going to...
Unless we're going to review Jurassic Park again.
And Terminator 2. Yeah. Those are the only things we're allowed to review in the 90s anymore. We already hit all the big ones like Total Recall.
Yeah.
What?
I don't know. I think my dad would disagree. I told him about watching The Rocketeer again, and he was like, oh my god, The Rocketeer? I love that movie. And I was like, yeah, I know. I remember we watched it a lot as a kid, so watching it again brought back a ton. I loved it for nostalgia's sake. Let's just say that.
I love it for all sake. I still like this movie a lot. It's not that good, obviously.
Well, yeah. I mean, I didn't dislike it watching it again, but... As an adult, it's like,
it's not as good as I thought it was. I honestly, first watch ever, I thought it was awesome. It had its flaws, for sure, but I enjoyed it every single moment of
this
it.
This is your first watch?
Yeah, I've never seen The Rocketeer. Awesome. Before this, I thought Rocketeer was just a video game for NES. Which, a very poor video game for NES, I should qualify that. Agreed.
So, it was directed by Joe Johnston, who, did Jurassic Park 3, of course, as well as...
just list Jurassic Park 3 first.
Yeah, I have to. And then, actually, a couple years ago, did the Marvel Studios version of Captain America. And after seeing this movie, I can totally see why Marvel Studios...
See why they were like, yeah, we need him to do it.
Oh, yeah. For sure. It stars Billy Campbell, who, after this movie, really was just
went right
a
off
lot
the cliff.
Of, lot of TV.
For the most
part. Hey, yeah. The Killing. He's in The Killing.
Yeah. I haven't watched The Killing. Is that good?
Well, I've seen a few episodes. My wife is a big fan. She likes it. She liked the first season, got her hooked. The second season, she was like, are they going to solve this fucking murder?
See, that's what I was going to say. I've heard a lot of people say, okay, we get it. It's not this guy.
Seriously.
It's like a line where they just move through people and you're like, okay, well, it's not going to be the person until the last episode.
They're throwing... the first two seasons are just basically... Just throwing out ideas of who killed this girl, one or two episodes of pursuing that lead and then it dying, not the lead person dying, but I don't know, that might happen too. I haven't seen enough, but the evidence trail goes cold, and
so it's like red herring the movie.
Seriously, two seasons. They made 2 years worth of episodes like that. So. Yeah.
Well, red herring the movie, the TV show.
Yeah.
So, this also stars Jennifer Connelly, who...
Super hot.
Yeah. And God, also...
Them boobs, though.
Philip texted me and was like, Jennifer Connelly's really hot in that. And I was... The only thing I said back was like, them boobies, though.
For real.
You guys know her from Labyrinth. You guys remember?
Of course.
Yeah.
And I recognize her from... Phantom of the Paradise. And,
she was in Phantom of the Paradise?
Dude, it's,
Wait a minute, I gotta look up
a musical, it's pretty fucking good.
Requiem for a Dream was probably the first movie that I I saw her in Rocketeer, but I was too young, but as an adult, I saw Requiem for a Dream.
Jennifer Connelly.
She was also in Dario Argento's Phenomena.
Oh, okay, I thought you were going to say Dracula.
No. I'm done talking about that movie. Ever.
Oh, man. Oh, shit.
Alan Arkin, who I think is a very underrated actor, he was probably the best actor in this movie, I thought.
He's one of a handful of people. Seriously, I read this, after I watched this movie, I got curious and started looking at the different people that were in it. He's one of a few people to be nominated for an Academy Award after his first movie ever.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's maybe 12 people ever to do that, and he's one of them.
He's really fucking good, and I think his most recent big work was Argo. But he
still have not seen Argo.
It's pretty good, but
probably most famously known for Popeye.
Yeah. Probably not.
No, probably not.
And then, of course, you have Timothy Dalton, who plays the villain in this, who I explained to Ben always looks like a son of a bitch. In every movie he's in, he just looks like a son of a bitch.
Yeah, God. He looks very, much like a rat. He's a rat man.
He's weaselly looking.
Yeah, very weaselly.
He has a terrible mustache in this movie.
Most
which
movies.
Doesn't
most true. Movies he's in. True. He has a giant turd lip mustache.
Turd lip?
Turd lip.
Oh, turd
like
lip.
A turd laying on top of his lip.
Oh, I get it.
It's weird, though, watching him in this movie play, spoiler alert, a Nazi spy when he's 2 years removed from playing Her Majesty, you know, like 007.
Yeah. Her Majesty's Secret Service.
Yeah, yeah, he's number one British spy.
Now, how many Bond movies was he in? Was it just
two.
One? Was it two?
I was gonna say he was okay. in two, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. License to Kill and...
From Russia with Love, was it?
I don't know. I think he's in License to Kill. I don't know
he's
the other one.
He's definitely in License to Kill.
Yeah, don't know the other one.
He was in License to Have a Terrible Mustache. That's the other one.
I liked his Bond movies. My mom and dad, who are Bond lovers, hate Timothy Dalton's movies.
They probably hate Daniel Craig, too, because...
Yes, they do. Very, my mom says Daniel Craig is terrible.
They're very...
I'm like,
no,
what?
He's awesome, because the thing
they
is...
they were born in the realm of Sean Connery.
Yeah. Well, and, yeah. Not only that, but Timothy Dalton and Daniel Craig are much closer to the character that James Bond is in the fucking book series, which is brutal and ass-kicking. Like...
Not nearly as many puns in other
words. Brosnan, Connery, and Roger Moore were all about the charm. And the books had a little bit of charm, but way more brutality and smarts. And Timothy Dalton was always seen as the dark Bond until Daniel Craig came on, and now he just kicks the shit out of everyone. Yeah.
Pierce Brosnan lost me when he windsurfed on a Arctic tidal wave that was like 500 feet tall.
It's not really his fault. That was pretty fucking dumb, but I don't necessarily blame him.
I don't blame him.
All right.
The series of movies he was in, yeah.
So let's get into the plot of The Rocketeer. And Philip, why don't you go over the plot?
There's a secret rocket technology that is being sought after by the mob, who are stealing it for what is later revealed to be the Nazi spy that works in Hollywood. And it falls in the hand of Pilot Cliff and his
boss.
Side character.
His boss slash best friend, PB.
Yeah. Yep.
His mentor mechanic.
Yeah.
You know, they make it seaworthy, I guess, airworthy, and he learns to fly it and gets him a helmet with a directional thing that would...
Jesus
for sure
Christ.
Kill him.
Howard Hughes was like, oh, you put a rudder on the helmet. That's brilliant. Never mind the fact that it would snap your fucking head off as soon as you turn.
So fast.
Okay, so let's talk about how they got this rocket jetpack thing in the first place.
Okay.
The mob has it, basically.
Well, they've stolen it. And they're
enter,
being chased after
yeah, the, enter car FBI. Chase, like... feds shooting up a gangster mobile, typical.
When did this movie take place? Was it the 40s?
30s.
Mid to late 30s.
Okay, the 30s. You ever guys ever noticed in movies like this, it takes place in the 30s and the car chase scenes are way faster than, you know, they would be in real life?
Yeah.
It's just cars max out at like 60 and they're just going, they're going 60 on country roads, which would be just impossible.
And it's through the forest and fields and shit.
I think
just
what
like,
they're
yeah.
doing is they're speeding it up because if you had a movie in that time, you would have sped it up.
Right.
To make it look like it were faster. You would just spin up the film, you know?
I don't think that's why they did that. I feel like it's way too smart for them to think of it like that. I think that they just...
They're adding substance to the car chase.
Yeah.
It's like they don't want it to be insanely boring. It's like, hey! Hey! It's like, I know you can hear me. Cause...
The FBI is just behind the monster car running after it.
Just chasing it on foot.
I was so happy to see that car chase because before that, it's just flying.
Mm-hmm.
And nothing else.
Yep.
And it is so goddamn boring. It's like, it went on for like the entire length of the credits, and it's like, fuck!
You know what? I can deal with the flying, because it was like a tenth of the flying in that stupid fucking scene in Superman, when they're just flying around aimlessly. And I'm like, okay, it's gonna be over now. Nope! Now they're doing telepathy for whatever reason.
What it reminded me of is last year I went to go see Pacific Rim in a theater. Mm-hmm. And before it, they played a trailer for Disney's Planes, where there was no dialogue at all. It was like 4 straight minutes of planes flying. They're not real planes, mind you. They're CGI planes, but they're just flying.
With smiley faces and stuff. Forgot that.
No, it's like they weren't showing off any personality. It was just, this is the job. The job is to fly. You will be impressed by flying. Look at it on a big screen.
Okay, so the car chase goes onto the airfield and fucks everything up. One of the mobsters hides the rocket pack and
swaps it for a vacuum cleaner.
Yeah, it is. Because they couldn't
understand.
Fucking tell that was a vacuum cleaner.
His whole plan the whole time was to explode the car and send it to a fiery death. Like, I mean, he grabs a vacuum cleaner, but first, can I just say, The guy's running away from the feds. They're running through a cornfield. Well, driving through a cornfield. And the guy sees a plane overhead and just fucking shoots it.
Yeah, he does.
Why?
He's a monster. He doesn't care.
Fuck this plane.
He seriously looked up and just said, fuck it. And shot the plane. I was like, why? That's the only... If you watch the movie... That is the event that brings the movie, like, brings him into the movie.
Yep.
Without the gunshots, his plane wouldn't have had to emergency land. He wouldn't have like, crashed and burned.
Shitty old plane.
Yeah, it would have just, things would have played out totally different. So he had to, it's like the director was like, how are we going to bring him in?
Nonsensical violence.
Let's just have the monster. He's a bad guy, and we're going to kill him off anyway. So he's just going to aim his Tommy gun at the sky.
Which one.
Which would have never hit that plane. In a billion years, you can't just shoot. If that was possible, there would be no such thing as SAM sites. Like, there would be no surface-to-air missiles to destroy planes. You could just shoot the sky and just kill them all.
Tommy gun is, like, one of the least accurate guns ever made. Ever.
That's why you shoot a lot of bullets with it. Because one of them might hit something.
Maybe.
Well, they got lucky, man.
I remember watching, I don't remember what show. Deadliest Warrior. You guys remember that show?
Yeah. Where they, like, hypothesize about who would kill who. Yeah.
Well, they had a Tommy gun on there, and it was a guy, they were talking about drive-bys, and they had this big mock bar set up. And they had, like, cars
the bullets
in front of
are gonna
it.
Hit something. Might as well be you.
Yeah, dude,
it's like losing the lottery.
They did a drive-by with an actual Tommy gun, and like out of a 50 bullet clip, which is one of those big round clips, I think two bullets hit like behind the bar where the glasses were, and nothing hit the car, and nothing hit like anything else even remotely close to it. Like, it's literally just something that makes really loud sounds.
I'm pretty sure they use it to, like, spell something out in Dick Tracy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And, well, the mobster has been in a police chase this whole time with the car driving directly behind him and beside him and can't hit anything. But he paints a stripe right across his plane that is flying at probably 100 miles an hour. And he's hanging out of the trunk of a, like, mid-30s
vehicle. Right, no fucking, you know,
no
what
sense.
Is it called?
No reason. Just no sense.
Nonsensical violence. That's it.
Yeah.
Nonsensical violence and just the bending of the laws of physics just to get him into the movie. But, I mean, of course, obviously.
But he has to be brought into the movie, and I'm glad he was.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Otherwise, there would be no one to fly the rocket pack because anyone else would die for sure.
Yeah.
Everyone else with their standard human neck muscles would not have been able to handle the rudder on the helmet.
It's so, being a pilot that gets him those neck muscles.
That's right.
Apparently. That's right.
So he figures out exactly, you know, what this thing is, basically. Yeah. And he tests it.
By destroying the fuck out of his boss's office.
Yeah.
By stealing,
they don't give
by
a
stealing
shit.
A wooden statue and chaining it to a stake out of Garfield.
They also don't give a shit about that office, too. Like, they just destroy it. And the boss is just doesn't even, like, pay attention to the fact
that...
care. He's already struggling for money.
He's kind of a mad scientist, I feel like.
Yeah,
he's the kind of person that's just, like, kind of out of his mind, super, super smart, and just... It's like, okay, well, let's try out this rocket pack. Why not?
Yeah.
And yet he was somehow the voice of reason in this situation. He was like, yeah, you don't want to try that out yourself. It's kind of explosive.
Okay,
but
so...
But he gives in.
Yeah,
yeah, he gives in pretty fucking quick.
It's like, yeah, okay, you're talking to me.
Well, he doesn't give in because the first time he actually uses it is during the air show. Mm-hmm. Where,
to save the crazy old World War One pilot that is dressed like a clown flying his plane.
Okay, they describe it as a clown act. You can't see him in the fucking plane.
Why is he wearing...
So why is he wearing the fucking clown makeup?
I don't know. I guess he's going to fly low enough and, like, upside down? Or
it's like, watch me make this balloon animal while I pass by you at 200 miles an hour.
I know he doesn't know how to fly the rocket pack yet, but the way he tries to save him by crashing into the bottom of the plane and scaring the shit...
Also would break his neck.
Man. Yeah. Like, never mind that the plane is made out of... Well, that's a really old plane, so it could be... a wooden plane with fabric, but still.
It's still wood. Slam into that with your neck at 400 miles an hour.
The guy running the show that he's now in is always reminded me, I think his name is John Polito. He always reminds me of poor man's Danny DeVito.
Wait a minute. Is he in Big Lebowski? Is he the other detective?
Yeah, he is.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm a fellow Snoop.
He's fucking poor man's Danny DeVito. He's just Danny DeVito if he wasn't crazy. Danny DeVito's crazy, and that's why he's popular.
Yep. And shorter, I think.
And just... way more troll-like. Way more likely to eat a fish raw.
Gushing blood.
Gushing. God, he's the pink.
Cliff saves this clown, guy in the clown suit, and John Polito's character then coins him as the Rocketeer. Yeah. What were the other stupid names that he was going to call
him? Oh, man.
They were bad.
they were bad. I can't remember. While you were saying Rocket that, I was trying to remember what the other ones were. I don't remember. But he's talking to the typical... like media. Group of newspaper reporters that are
he's literally got every single newspaper reporter in his office. This is what time we're talking about in history.
The whole time that whole rescue scene is going on, just bad shit is happening and he's just yelling how it's all part of the show.
It's all part of the show.
When this fucking plane crashes into a group of people. Is it all part of the show then?
He doesn't care.
Another tanker explodes, by the way. His own like fuel tank. He has two of them explode.
And, of course, they have the gag. He tells them, as soon as they get there, he's like, now park it really far away from the airfield. They're like, oh, okay. They park it far away, and it makes no difference.
None.
Plane still crashes right into it.
Really, the only announcement he needs to be making is that there won't be any refunds.
Yeah.
Like, feel free to run away, but there will be no refunds.
Yeah, I don't really get... I guess he's keeping them there for popcorn sales, or, like, the sales of the program.
He's literally Danny DeVito's character from Big Fish. Just the swindling circus manager.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's what you would say when an elephant runs away from the show. And you're like, everybody
remain calm. We wanted that elephant to kill that midget.
Part of the show.
This is so terrible.
What you didn't know was the midget was a child molester.
Oh my god, we need to get back on track real bad.
We are perfectly on track. Okay, so now the news of the Rocketeer has spread. Timothy Dalton is basically behind the mob, giving them money to get a hold of the rocket pack.
Right.
And, you know, they don't care why, because he's giving them money. And he is...
Right,
because
they're the fucking mob.
Exactly. And Timothy Dalton is, like, one of the highest paid actors in Hollywood at this time.
Top three, I think.
And he looked,
he's like, I'm the third highest grossing.
Yeah, well, congratulations. You're still gonna.
Who are number one and two? It's all over.
And, I think they talked about him.
And also, he is currently filming a really shitty looking movie where he looks like Indigo Montoya.
Yeah, so he's filming Princess Bride too.
Yeah, what? Sword fights up a spiral staircase.
So bad.
Coincidentally, Jennifer Connelly, who is Cliff's love interest, is also an actress and working on the same movie that Timothy Dalton is working
Aspiring.
On.
Aspiring.
Mm-hmm.
She's trying to get the big role.
That's right.
Yep.
Okay, so Timothy Dalton just kills somebody on a set. Or not kills them, but stabs them.
Yeah, right. I didn't...
Oh, I didn't mean to do that.
I'll have you see my... personal doctor. Like he's like,
it's
put
like,
him in the van
fuck,
and take
don't
him.
Trust stabbed yeah. me.
And
he's
later,
a Nazi doctor.
Yeah, later in the movie, that's what I'm thinking. I'm like, did that guy just get shipped off to a Nazi scientist?
You're like, wait a minute. He's going to his personal doctor? I don't think the guy's going to be Jewish.
The rest of the meat of this movie is basically some fighting going on between Cliff and Jennifer Connelly, as well as the mob basically searching this town, you know, through and through to find the Rocketeer.
And the FBI.
Right, so everybody's looking for him, basically. And, okay, what about that part where they walk into the diner and they just assume that somebody in that fucking diner knows who the Rocketeer is?
Well, it's the only diner on the airfield.
But there's, like...
The airfield is... That's, like, literally everyone in there is from the... It's, like, that's why the diner is there.
So the Rocketeer has to be somebody from the airfield.
They already knew that he was.
Oh, that's right.
Because they picked
him
up and then...
Yeah, they didn't just walk into a random diner and be well, like, they, somebody in here knows!
They a little bit did.
But I mean, they clearly did a good job. He was among them.
Yeah. Which they didn't know.
They didn't, you know.
Fuck up real
the
bad,
guiltiest dude. Looking guy in the whole group.
Right. And
he's like, oh, it wasn't me.
And I'm pretty sure the diner owner, the woman, was Hannah Montana's grandma.
Well, I wouldn't know.
Like,
you mean Grandma Montana?
Yeah, Grandma Montana. She was also in Justified, if you guys have ever watched Justified.
I have not.
But I have seen Deadwood, so it's just the same thing.
It is not the same thing.
I like telling you that it is.
Nothing alike. If Arnold were here, he would nothing alike you so hard.
So hard. Nothing alike. You're a quiet boy compared to me.
So they figure out that... they figure out that he's the Rocketeer basically through his girlfriend, who has pictures up on the wall.
Picture on the wall, yeah.
And
them two together in front of his plane.
That's right.
With a sign that says, "I'm the Rocketeer," and then on the back there's a list of his fears and his schedule.
Yeah. Which pretty much was, because that's when they go immediately to his house.
Right.
Or not his house, but Peavy's house.
And shoot up
and
everything.
And, yeah.
But we've skipped over a very key moment in this movie.
And a very key character.
Yeah.
And are you going to be talking about the really shitty henchman with the really shitty makeup?
The guy that walked straight off of the Dick Tracy set onto this.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
He was from Dick Tracy, I'm pretty fucking sure.
I love that guy. I love that guy. My favorite, actually my favorite scene in this whole movie was starring him. Part of him, anyway. When he goes into the hospital to interrogate the mobster that survived, that's under police protection, and he pretty much kills the guy and hangs him up in his body cast stirrups. Yeah,
he's a marionette. Just,
he broke him in half.
Destroys this guy, and he's massive. I mean, he's real life 7 foot tall.
Yeah,
and really ugly.
You also forgot to mention he wisps out the window before the cops can get in.
The cop finally hears over his radio program, and he runs in there and sees the guy hanging around in his, suspension body cast.
And he's like, well,
1930s, medical technology. And he rushes to the window and looks out, and there's nothing there. But from the camera angle looking down, you see these giant fucking feet on this little ass ledge. These giant black orthopedic shoes, and they twinkle back. They're like ticka 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 ticka, off screen. My favorite part of that whole movie.
Yeah, so outrageous.
We've several times on this podcast talked about the oldest trick in the book, and they've been several different things. But honestly, when you chase somebody out a fucking window, do you not know now to just look to the side?
Just look out the window a little bit and turn your head slightly to the right or left.
He has a 7 foot tall.
Or
You're forgetting the counter to that, which is, you stuck your head out the window. Now I own your head.
Yeah.
I can either smash it or I can throw you out.
That's why you carefully look until they come into view. Yeah. You don't just stick your head out a fucking whack-a-mole.
And he's a fucking police officer, so I'd be like looking with a gun.
It's called investigate.
Yeah. He's obviously not a very good police officer because he's chilling on crippled guard duty at the hospital.
And he was thirsty too.
He was clearly after that fucking nurse, but he was I'll totally listen to this radio program with you. Yeah.
Isn't that funny?
Waiting for the mob to show up at any given moment.
Oh my god.
So going back to that guy, he is now in this
he's basically indestructible.
He's Timothy Dalton's personal henchman.
Yeah.
I mean, he calls him on the phone and you see this giant hand answer this big rotary phone and it's like, "I have work for you today."
Yeah.
And then that's when it goes to the hospital.
Well, it's real good later whenever you see him eating teeny little chicken wings too. It's just a massive guy with tiny wings.
And his chin is 4 feet long. So,
that was makeup.
The craziest makeup I've ever seen.
It was really shitty.
It's so bad, but they obviously did it badly on purpose. I mean, at this point, we have to assume that.
They actually made him up to look like a kind of a star. He was from that time because he had a fucked up face. The guy's name was Rondo Hatton. And he had a seriously fucked face, but they were going to use him to be a monster.
You know, a movie he was in makeup is Ace Ventura, Pet Detective. He is one of the henchmen that kidnaps Dan Marino. He is obviously the giant henchman.
The one that kidnapped Dan Marino.
Yeah, yeah. He is that guy.
Good. Yeah, he breaks into PV's house, and he's just beating the shit out of both of them. And then the FBI shows up.
Let them have it, boys!
Instead of, first they're just standing out there. And rather than this guy just running out the fucking back window,
decides to shoot at the fucking...
One more oldest trick in the book. Since when do police not go to both sides of the house?
They don't in movies whenever people need to escape. That's the only fucking... We got you halfway surrounded!
We've got you semi-surrounded!
There's only one escape. See if you can find it. It's probably near the back exit of the house.
Follow my voice. It's not in the opposite direction.
Go away from the line.
Yeah. So rather than just run out the back window, this fucking huge guy decides to pull out both of his pistols and just start randomly shooting at all the police officers.
Well, he hates coppers.
Yeah, he does.
That is
most Nazis do.
Yeah.
I don't think he's a Nazi, though.
He was just he is a Nazi. He was just a long
I don't think
the
Nazis would put up with his existence. Like, I feel like he would have been racially cleansed way before. He's okay, way too much
in
of a
reality. In reality, he probably would have
been. They're like, oh, well, we'll probably find somebody who's blonde to replace you.
Nothing could kill him anyway. I mean, it took a blimp exploding in the air while he was tied to it.
I can't wait to get to the fucking blimp explosion.
Okay. Yeah.
7-minute long blimp explosion.
Speaking of explosion, what I fully believe is the Rocketeer's actual superpower is just being fireproof. Because
I thought you said that was his superpower.
No, what do you mean?
You texted me and said that was his superpower.
Yeah, it's sarcastically.
I thought he was that makes sense now. Okay. You fucking told me that, I was like, yeah, it's totally a superpower now. That's what I thought.
No, he has no superpowers except apparently having a really strong neck.
He's not.
Strong
he's
neck
not
and fireproof legs.
Yeah. He's fucking fireproof, dude.
Because how would he, like.
He goes in that fucking laundry
chute. Everybody knows that whenever you set alcohol on fire, it burns in a very cool way.
No, what I'm saying, yeah.
I mean, everybody knows that that's not true.
When he's in that fucking laundry chute. And it's just a steel laundry chute, and then he just lights up or whatever in there, and you see fire go out the fucking both ends of it, and you're like, what the fuck happened to him? Isn't he crispy? Like, he just comes out like,
well, he's wearing a helmet, and he's got a leather jacket, so he's cool.
That helmet would have cooked his fucking head like a roast inside.
Steven,
maybe.
I think you're forgetting about the fact that this guy should already be dead a million times over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Stop trying to say, oh, well, he should be dead at this point. It doesn't matter. He should have died already a thousand times.
I'm not trying to say that. I'm just saying this is one of his many superpowers. Apparent superpowers, not actually
besides
real.
Having a neck of steel and being able to withstand just crashing face first into a pond at 3,000 miles per hour, yeah. Fucking fast he's going.
And when the guy finds him, he's like in the reeds, like...
It's like, people jump off the top of a building into fucking 400 stories to a trash can, and they're like, oh, too bad this trash can is full of stuffing.
You broke your arm, like, falling what, like 4 feet or something like that?
No, I didn't fall at all. I was literally standing on a skateboard and just fell down and broke my arm.
So it's like, this guy flies, like, 1,000 feet and, like...
Yeah.
However fast.
I weighed like 100 pounds at that time, though, I have to say. Like, I was not... There was not much to me.
It doesn't matter. You fell over, and this guy, like, hits...
I'm just a regular human, but, yeah, so is this fucking guy. He would be 1,000% dead so quick.
After the initial flight, every other flight, he lands on his feet.
Well, he's perfected it.
Yeah, he's
point.
Perfected it after one try.
Yeah.
So what we're saying is he really does have many superpowers.
Yes, he's an excellent pilot.
Well, there are people that exist that just happen to be awesome at everything. These people do exist. And he may have just magically learned it. But you can't just magically learn to not have your spine removed but if you crash face first into a fucking pond.
Yeah.
Going 3 million miles an hour.
Like, I don't know why, but since he brought up Arrested Development earlier... Now I'm just, like, thinking that how good this movie would be if it was just Michael Cera in that jetpack suit that he gets from Japan or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, that, you know, that was just the Rocketeer, too.
Yeah.
Okay, but, so it's revealed that Timothy Dalton is a fucking no-good... Dirty, rotten Nazi spy.
By Jennifer Connelly. She's snooping around. She finds a secret radio room in his mansion after he's already
drugged her.
Kidnapped her. Yeah.
Chlorophyll
like,
her face.
Like, yeah. And, and she wakes up and she's like, oh, where am I? And he's like, oh, it's just the chlorophyll. It'll wear off.
Yeah.
Or chlorophyll.
Chlorophyll.
More like
chlorophyll.
Oh, it's just the chlorophyll. I've got
oh,
lots
it's just
of house plants in there.
Yeah. Also, like, after that, she, like, tries this weird seduction thing with him. You know
yeah,
what I mean? And it's like, at that point, if I've just used chloroform on somebody, and they,
Timothy
like...
Timothy Dalton is clearly a moron.
Yeah.
It's like, so... oh, yeah, she won't hold it against me that I kidnapped her. She'll think that's fine. Also, that I fucking just put her into my bed.
I have to believe that the Nazis had a better fucking spy that they could have used for this. Like, why,
yeah,
why
he's
this
definitely
guy?
The worst
well, because
ever.
He has so much money.
Money. Yeah, I guess.
Money.
He can pay the mob to do it.
He's not German.
Yeah.
Is he? I mean...
No. I mean, he's...
We don't know.
He doesn't. Why yeah, is he it's never
He's
said.
An actor.
That's
he
right.
He could be having any voice.
But we do.
And, he does do shitty German accent at the end, if you guys didn't know.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah.
Oh
my it's gosh. Really bad.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
I feel like they would have definitely executed him just for how poor he does German. Yeah. But anyway, so Jennifer Connelly pulls off the only good acting in the movie. I mean, in the movie, and fools Timothy Dalton into thinking she just wants to bang him now for whatever reason. She's like, oh, help me get undressed. And then she smashes a pot on his head. Well, once again, the oldest fucking trick in the book. It's like, here, unzip my dress for 5 minutes while I reach around over here for this thing that you don't know about. It's your bathroom.
It's like, if I'm going to unsuspectingly be hit with a pot, where am I going to stand? I'm next to the pot.
Yeah. He's all, I mean, he's thinking, she's totally into me.
Yeah.
She doesn't care.
No, he's like, well, I am a movie star. I mean, I definitely planned on molesting her while she was asleep. Probably I did. But,
you know. I at least touched a boob.
And I mean, honestly, how could he have not?
Them boobies, though.
Yeah, for real.
He hits her with lines from his own fucking movies. Movies that he knows yes. that she's seen. Oh, my God. Why would you fucking do that?
God, he's and the worst actor playing an actor ever.
Yeah.
Like, what?
It's like, it was only an act when I sat in those movies.
So she discovers the broadcast station that's hidden inside of his...
conveniently, like...
Yeah.
Conveniently hidden.
What do you... She press a button? I don't remember how she...
No, she watched...
She finds a notebook.
She saw him...
like a little
she
black
saw him
book.
Pulling on books in a different... You know, she knew that he came out of a
secret
passage.
Yeah. And you just open it.
What is the book? It's a...
I can't remember.
It's something that is so...
Blatantly
stupid.
Terrible.
Out of place.
Yeah. Well, she's like searching and pulling books, and then she finds this one, big one, and oh my god.
It's like how
I
to take over
remember.
The world or some shit.
Oh god.
Yeah, it's
Mein
like.
Kopf.
It's yeah. I'm not a Nazi, please don't pull on this book.
God, I have to know.
Okay, so she finds out he's a Nazi, and.
He discovers her at the moment. Of her discovery.
That's right.
Like, the door creaks open, and it's him with the giant, flabby, like, ice pack thing that from the 30s, you know, like a big,
right.
wet thing
still
on his
get
head.
Those, and I feel like it'd be such a great thing to have. It'd save me so much in Ziploc bags that I have to use instead.
And then behind him is Lothar, who is the 7-foot henchman.
The scariest man ever to walk.
Yeah.
And
so, I think we can skip over the whole ballroom scene that was really lame and terrible.
Where they hid next to the giant clam.
Yeah, it was really stupid. He drops a note into her soup like he obviously wouldn't notice that.
Was the giant clam, was that like a thing back in the 30s?
Oh, it's yeah.
Like,
so
I,
many
I
movies.
Every
Indiana
like
Jones.
The big band orchestra and there's a giant fucking
giant
clam.
Giant clam, yeah.
What is that?
I don't know.
Well, I guess they're saying that the woman is the pearl or whatever, but at the same time it's like, yeah.
There's definitely a giant clam in
well,
Temple
all,
of Doom.
It was all just a plot by Temple the giant clam corporation to sell all these giant clams that they made.
Yeah. I wonder where all of the giant clams that didn't get used are at this moment.
Speaking of giant things from movies that haven't been used, my dad, we were talking about The Rocketeer, and he was like, oh, when me and your mom were in California, we went to the Hollywood Studios or Universal Studios, and he said that the diner... The big dog that's like the diner
yeah.
is on the back lot.
Yep.
It's just still like sitting there going.
They have some things from this at the Orlando Hollywood Studios also. They've got the helmet and the jetpack. And then
well,
the plane,
the
yellow plane is out there where all the vehicles are and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty cool.
There's a very convoluted plot. We'll just say everyone meets up at the observatory.
Yeah.
Let's not get into it. It's really ridiculous. Literally, the FBI, the mob, the entire Nazi army, for whatever reason,
isn't
is somehow there.
Isn't Howard
yeah,
Hughes
where
there too?
Where did the Nazi soldiers come
I don't
from?
Know.
The bushes.
I'm like, oh, why do they need Timothy Dalton? They've clearly invaded America.
Yeah, Timothy Dalton is
Nazi
like...
Nazi soldier factory maker in the back. They just press a button and Nazi soldiers come out.
After Timothy Dalton is finally revealed to be a Nazi spy to the mobster, and the mobster's like, I'm not fighting anymore because I may not make an honest buck, but I'm still American. Like, he says that.
Yeah.
And then Timothy Dalton's like, no matter, I have this backup Nazi
army
backup waiting plan. In these bushes over here.
It's totally fucking Hail Hydra from Captain America.
It is.
Yeah,
like, it's
it
just...
Is,
just
sure.
Press a button and 4,000 Hydra soldiers come out and
yeah.
they're everywhere.
Yeah.
Sometimes you need some backup, man.
Yeah, underground bunkers just everywhere. I have one under my house.
There just happens to be also a Nazi blimp touring the United States for whatever
they
reason.
Yeah, they seed that. They plant that little nugget during the TV broadcast earlier in the movie. And they also plant the seed that they didn't have helium available to them, so they used hydrogen. They used really explosive hydrogen. They said it in the TV broadcast within the movie.
When was the Hindenburg? When did that whole thing go down?
I want to...
Was that before this movie was set?
Apparently it was after this movie was made, because they didn't realize that when you explode the Hindenburg, for instance, it goes up in half of a second. Everything is gone.
The Hindenburg happened in 1937.
Okay, so
this was, I think, this movie took place. Yeah,
it is the Hindenburg.
This is literally the Hindenburg.
I think that's what this was. Like, the plot was, they were trying to add to that disaster.
It was like, oh no, this is the reason why the Hindenburg blew up.
It just had a different name.
Yeah.
It was. I don't remember what it was called in the movie. But
well, it doesn't matter.
It was the Slindenburg.
It was the Murray-denburg.
Oh.
So, yeah, if you've ever seen the footage of the Hindenburg exploding, the reason they can't figure out why it blew up or where the flashpoint was or where it exploded from is because there's two frames. There's one where it's whole and then one where it's all fire. And there's no way to know where it started because it was instantaneous.
Right.
Which is what it would have been on this fucking thing.
Because the entire thing is...
It's like, oh, there's a fire in the cabin? You're all already dead.
Yeah, that part pissed me off to no end because there's just...
She shoots a flare gun in a giant blimp full of hydrogen gas.
Well, movie over. You're all fucked.
And the Rocketeer's like, no, don't do that. It's like, but then again, I guess it didn't do anything.
He was flying a fucking jetpack into it. Yep. So it's with
a piece of gum holding on a fuel leak.
I really think that the gum is the superhero of the movie, by the way.
The gum is the superhero.
It's Lucky Pilot gum.
He was basically, he was chewing... I don't know, two-part epoxy the whole time, or, like, J.B. Weld?
Yeah, I don't know what it was, but it would not have...
gum.
Even if it was J.B. Weld, it still wouldn't have worked. So preposterous. So, Timothy Dalton kidnaps Jennifer Connelly, they're on the blimp, and they're escaping, and they're, like, yelling Nazi slang out the window.
Yeah,
and
the random
fuck
Nazi,
you!
The random Nazi guy in Timothy Dalton's ear that is, like... so excited and just yelling at him, and finally, he pushes him out
the
window.
Smoochile! Smoochile!
Yeah. Fucking Smoochile. Oh, shit. So, yeah, there's a fight on board, and somehow, I'm not even sure how, but the fucking giant henchman gets himself up on top of the blimp. Fully impossible.
Yeah,
okay.
Well, he grabs a leash and he tethers himself and then climbs out.
Is there such a thing as a tube that goes through the center of the hydrogen? Yeah, that seems like it would be short.
Like, I'm just picturing.
Oh
like,
my god, I didn't even think about it. Oh my god, how the fuck did he get up?
Impossible.
I'm picturing that tube from Willy Wonka. Where it goes up in the
Augustus
chocolate.
Augustus.
That's what it would have had it been. Because imagine, you're a 7-foot-tall man that can barely walk just because you're so gigantic. Because your feet are just, they don't even make shoes for you.
Yeah.
And he just climbs up the 400-mile-long ladder up to the top of the blimp that goes through the fictitious tunnel in the middle
God,
of the blimp.
Where did he go?
I don't know.
Yeah, how did he get up there? Who the hell knows?
It's Dennis Hopper in Speed. Getting on top.
We forgot to add, Lortho or whatever his name is also a gecko. He just climbs right out the side.
Dude, in an action movie, you can get on top of any vehicle.
It doesn't matter how fast. So, there's a fight scene up there between him and Monster Face.
Yeah.
And Monster Face ends up swinging off the edge.
Yep. He has to use the jetpack to pretty much beat him.
Yeah.
And he pushes him off the side. And he swings and busts into the cabin of the blimp.
Hits his face on the fucking frame of the window.
Smokes the pilot.
Yeah. Out the other side of the
just
fucking
shoots him out almost.
I did love the comedy of that scene though. Yeah. Whenever he's sitting there and he's like, "We're fine. We have a pilot.
He's the finest pilot in the world." Well, and there he goes.
Well, we have the finest co-pilot.
I really wish they would have said that. That would have been excellent. We have the second best pilot as well. who just like moved up to number
Simpsons
one.
Simpsons moment or
yeah,
something.
Yeah, totally. I mean, it kind of was that. So he saves the day and escapes out the side of the cabin of the blimp. And there's somehow, I can't even remember how, because it's all very ridiculous. Timothy Dalton tries to fly away.
Yeah, he holds him at gunpoint to get the rocket pack. And he gives it to him. As after he, like, sneakily slid that chewed piece of gum
which
off
was just
of
laying right on top, not even...
Yeah. Because it had a bullet hole in it. We forgot that.
Yeah, bullet hole from the mobster shooting while it was in the attic of the diner.
Right, 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 right.
When it should have exploded.
Yeah. No, man, it rained on alcohol.
Dude, alcohol is not flammable except whenever it's in a rocket not being on fire. Okay.
Rocket alcohol is very flammable.
Rocket alcohol. Where do they sell that?
With a seemingly endless supply.
Yeah, I mean, where did they get more? I mean, what, is it just run off of straight moonshine or what?
I guess. I feel like rocket
alcohol
will fuck you up something just...
Fierce. I don't think rocket alcohol is a thing. That's the thing that we're getting at here.
Well, they...
So Timothy Dalton flies off about 5 feet and then
brutally dies.
Awesome. I've got to say, I was impressed with the CG on that part. Like Timothy Dalton, like sputtering and then just blowing up.
Yeah, you're
just legs and intestines falling to the earth.
You're like, oh, he's fucked. Like, there's no getting away
no
from
question.
It. He crashes into the Hollywood sign.
Yeah, which says Hollywood land, and he crashes into the land, and it's just Hollywood. Like, well, that's how the Hollywood sign got made.
That's the Hindenburg, and that's the Hollywood sign. History. Oh,
thank you.
History's
why is this going on in a residential part of fucking Los Angeles, and there's no, like, seriously, where's the National Guard? Where's, like,
and
everybody?
And then the papers.
Where's the National Guard when they're fighting Nazi army,
Oh, my God.
And then there's the papers the next morning that are, like, the,
Neville
the actor Neville Sinclair.
Sinclair.
The actor Neville Sinclair tragically died. Didn't they say
and a house fire. It
house
was
fire.
Like a house fire.
And it's like, no,
house...
I saw that motherfucker flying in a jetpack and blow up midair.
Yeah, I also heard him screaming Nazi propaganda on his way down. So the my most bullshit part of the whole movie, the fucking blimp is currently exploding. They're all just wondering, oh, well, what should we do? What's our escape plan? Well, I don't know. The blimp is exploding.
Let's get to the roof.
Let's climb.
Through
Volfar's
magic tunnel.
Through his magic elevator tunnel. It's a magic elevator tunnel in the middle of the blimp. Well, let's just chill out up here for a while until someone decides to show up and save us with their plane. You know, it's at least 3 or 4 minutes on screen time, probably 10 minutes of exploding in their time.
Inside of the blimp. As
all of which would have taken
good old
less than a whole second.
PV and Howard Hughes come to the rescue, and PV hollers back at Howard and is like,
throw down the rope, Potter!
Hold her steady, we only get one shot at this. And it's like, what?
The plane would have exploded. The people would have been dead.
You know how hot that, just the heat from the explosion, just ruined
the plane
everything.
Would have melted, probably. The people would have all, for sure, been dead. It's all very bullshit.
But
that's
I love
everything
it.
Up until this point has been bullshit. Oh, I laughed so loud when that part happened. It's
but
just
the exploding when they're running. They're running away from the exploding part of the blimp.
Yeah,
but
because apparently
Lothar is still
blimp.
Alive, and he's still tethered to the blimp, and he's running with them until he hits the end of his belt, and he's like,
well,
he turns around and faces the fire, and like a typical death of a
villain.
Stupid henchman. He dies in such a stupid way.
He comes back in Rocketeer 2 slightly more ugly. That's all. That's the only difference. He fell 200 feet. He got exploded by a blimp. Doesn't matter.
You know, I believe this was a comic, by the way.
I'm pretty sure it was, and that's what I thought you were referencing. I thought you were like, oh, his superpower from the comic.
I don't know whether the comic came out before the movie or the comic came out
probably
after.
Before.
I feel like it was probably before.
They never make movies
like
just out of the blue. They always are based on something that has an established audience already.
I think this was based on the Commander Cody that I talked about from the Misery episode. Because it was pretty much the exact same setup.
Yeah, Rocketeer made his first appearance in 1982.
Yeah, unfortunately, apparently in the comic book, he looked like the bad guy from Hellboy.
He looks like if no, he looks like
he looks like the fish guy or whatever.
Yeah.
With the,
I was gonna say he looks like Cannonball and the Iron Giant had a kid.
Yeah, he does. He does have.
But he has
the
such
Iron
a
Giant.
Like he has such a Nazi looking outfit. Like look at that outfit.
I mean, his helmet is basically somebody took a a saw to a vintage radio and cut out the middle and glued the parts back together.
I actually think that's what he did do.
No, I mean, that's the helmet.
Yeah, I mean, he I think he did. He took,
Commander Cody!
Yeah, he was influenced by Commando Cody.
Yeah!
Commando Cody.
God. The helmet.
Forgetting about the fact that it wouldn't protect him from shit.
Nothing. Yeah, no matter what.
Good God. I think we have to move on.
We do have to move on. I just wanted to say, though, like, I'm glad that Joe Johnson did this movie, because I was super impressed with the Captain America movie he did, and this was definitely, like, the right paveway.
Yeah, this was Captain America 0.5.
The Windows 95 Captain America, and Captain America was the Windows XP.
Right.
This is basically a really fun, like, a kids movie, back when you could still show kids Nazis.
Or, you know,
my parents had no problem letting me watch this. Yeah. I loved it when I was a kid. I mean,
it's like, those are the bad guys, son.
It's like making you remember. It's like, well, this is 91, and it's been 50 years since we've had, you know, we need to remind the kids of this generation.
Yeah.
These guys were totally dicks.
All three Indiana Jones movies did that. Well, not the second one, but two of them did.
Yeah.
Basically.
But I mean, honestly, Nazis are always the bad guy for one simple reason. They're basically the most evilest thing we know of to just reference back and be the bad guy. And like, nobody likes Nazis except for other Nazis.
And it's such a simple, like, oh, slap an arm patch on the guy, you got a fucking Nazi.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep. There's no costume required.
All you need is a fucking red armband.
Yeah.
We've, like, have you guys noticed that in the last, like, couple of months, we've just had a shitload of movies with Nazis in them?
Lots of movies have Nazis.
I know, but, like, particularly the ones we've been doing.
Without Nazis, Hollywood wouldn't exist.
Okay.
Dead Alive?
Yeah.
Both of those had fucking Nazis in them.
Yeah, that's all you had.
And this one. So that's three in the last fucking 3 weeks.
Okay.
Fine. Okay, the last month. Was there a Nazi in Under Siege somewhere?
I mean, they were threatening castration. Are we going to split hairs here? Am I wrong?
All right, you guys want to move on to The Shadow?
Yeah. Not particularly, but let's go ahead.
The Shadow.
I like Baldwin's foray into superhero-dom, which fell flat on its fucking stupid ass, terrible makeup face. I think the theme of this podcast should be people who have really horrible makeup.
Yeah. He starts off with those gross fingers.
Oh my God. I have a thing about fingernails. Like, and his, like, they're, oh my, dude. I wanted to, I can't even say a sentence because his fingernails were so bad.
Okay, this movie starts with Alec Baldwin, white bread motherfucker, as a crime lord in Mongolia.
Yeah, he's in a fucking opium den.
How the fuck did he get there?
He killed his way to the top, DeHart.
Well, I read...
He killed his way from the top in America? Wasn't born in fucking Mongolia.
I did a little bit of reading.
You move up the chain, and eventually you end up in Mongolia in an opium den.
Okay, a little bit of reading on The Shadow. Comes to find out that he is like a World War One. He was a soldier in World War One. A bunch of bad things happened to him. And he ends up, like, going and becoming this drug lord. Like, there wasn't a lot of backstory from what I read. So, I mean,
didn't really require it.
I called him kind of like a welfare Batman. And
Batman!
Yeah, like, going...
Well,
yeah.
But the thing is Brian Moriarty from Nerds on Film.
Yeah.
You know, that dude knows everything. And and went back and he was like, actually, The Shadow predates Batman by, like, 10 years. And it's like, yeah, this is came into the magazine in the 30s. And also,
something could come before you and still be welfare that. Yeah. For sure.
Yeah, and
remember your MP3 player that was like the size of a brick and weighed that much?
Yes, I do.
It's like, yeah, just because the iPod came afterwards doesn't mean it's not better. Way better.
Yeah.
It had a fucking laptop hard drive inside it that you could remove and put more in.
Yeah, it did. It was awful.
God, that was ridiculous.
So, this was directed in 1994 by Russell Mulcahy.
Mulcahy.
Directed Highlander and Highlander 2, The Quickening.
Highlander, which I really like, and Highlander 2, which is horrible.
Yeah. The Quickening.
You like Highlander?
The first one?
Damn you to hell.
I think it's awful.
That movie blows goats. All of the goats. Your snake is escaping, like, right now.
He is not escaping.
He's obviously escaping.
The thing's on. The lid's on.
Yeah, well, the lid's been on before.
Also directed...
Guess that's not the same fucking snake that's already escaped a dozen times.
Resident Evil Extinction, which was like the third Resident Evil, which was shitty. I stopped watching them after that one. So...
The second one
very
so
hidden.
Good. I love the second Resident Evil. I haven't...
He also directed Scorpion King 4, or whatever.
I love how it doesn't even... It's not even a movie, it's a video. Scorpion King 4, video.
There's not a lot of, like, segue between Alec Baldwin's, well, The Shadow, his life as a drug lord in Mongolia, and he's, like, what? He's randomly summoned by this guy to come to this temple. And he shows up at the temple, fingernails clacking in the wind, long hair, terrible fucking makeup, weird-looking eyeballs, and he tries to... show how bad he is by assaulting this guy with a dagger, and he's like, you don't want to touch that dagger, man. And he's like, man, I'll do what I want. I'm this like, drug lord.
This is like the shitty ghetto like gang argument between the two, by the way, narrated by Ben.
Yeah, basically. I'm summarizing for everybody.
And he was like, man, you don't want to touch that dagger.
He was like, you don't want to touch that dagger.
He was like, man, please.
He's like, this fucking dagger, this is my dagger now. I'm going to kill you with it, or I'm going to try to. And he's like, you don't have the power to control that dagger. And the dagger, all of a sudden, turns into, like, he turns around, and it's like a Buddhist carving. It's not Buddha, but it's like a Buddha-like Shiva carving head, and it opens up with a mouth full of fangs and bites his fucking hand.
Bites
and,
the shit out of his hand,
yes,
too, by the
yes,
way.
Yes, terrible. And then it hovers above him and, like, stabs him in the leg, like...
And makes crazy pterodactyl sounds, too.
Yes,
like,
yes.
Well, it's a snake man dagger.
Oh.
It's a snake woman dagger. It's the worst.
It is a three-bladed, like, it's a three-sided dagger. And I wanted to say something about Alec Baldwin's acting during that scene and how bad he is at, like, acting with violence, I guess. I mean, I really like Alec Baldwin in a lot of things, but him getting stabbed in the leg was so funny. Like, it was so funny.
Oh, my leg!
he looks at it like Jim Carrey in Ace Ventura 2. Yeah. I was like, ah!
This is my explanation for how I feel this movie was made. I feel like that there's just this ultimate being named Hollywood.
Yeah,
and Alec Baldwin walked into Hollywood's office and was like, I want to be Batman. and they were like, you have a really good Batman voice, but no. Michael Keaton's
Yeah,
be
we've
Batman.
Got that one already.
And but you can be
like your paper shuffling.
Yeah, he's like he's like no, not the 19 he's like no, not Captain America.
Got that one.
The Shadow. This is a shitty character from like the 30s that you can
Shadow.
Be. I really wanted to be Batman, so
I'm just going to play it like Batman.
So what does the Shadow do? Well,
he really doesn't do anything. See, he just kind of gets in people's minds.
Yeah.
And he says, hey, you know what? You can't see me. Fuck you.
So you learn pretty quickly that you can teach somebody telepathy, but only if you live in Mongolia.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah. Yep.
And so he goes back, and there's a really like confusing scene for me where he's talking to the... he's talking to his friend from the police force or from the mayor's office or from wherever the fuck that guy's from. He clearly knew him from before because he's like, well, I remember 6 years ago when you disappeared. And so what happened was he vanished from there, immediately went straight to Mongolia and became a drug lord within a minute. And then from there, came straight back.
So wait. Are we saying he's a drug lord because he was just in an opium den?
No, he was obviously a drug lord. Like,
yeah,
he was
like pulling the strings when they shot that guy. And he's like, the guy's holding his boy hostage and he's like,
fuck you.
He's like, you won't shoot me. You can't shoot around me. And he's like, shoot through him. And then like, shoots his own fucking friend. Oh my god.
He's like, well, you've been a good friend up until right now. Like,
kills his buddy.
That was the pop quiz from Speed. Pop quiz, hotshot.
He's like, what do you do? He's like, well,
I'll
just shoot him in the chest 5 times.
Ideally, you're not supposed to kill the hostage. But, you know.
So... whenever it kind of flashes forward a little bit and you're seeing Lamont Cranston's character.
Lamont.
Which is
Cranston.
So
Lamont, you big dummy.
It's Bryan Cranston's black half brother.
Wow.
Anyway.
No, I think we're being confusing right now. This is Alec Baldwin's character. Yeah. That's the Shadow's.
The Shadow slash his street, his like given name was Lamont Cranston.
Right, right.
Like Bruce Wayne, Batman.
Oh, good connection there. Yeah. But anyway, and he also seems to be a billionaire.
Yeah, he seems to like the guy he goes out to dinner with all the time keeps giving him shit about not like, having to do anything.
Yeah, kind of like Lieutenant Gordon.
Yeah, like, oh, somebody has to work around here. We can't all just have a trust fund, blah, blah, blah.
He does have telepathy, and also he probably had a little bit of money from his whole drug lord thing.
just
walk into a bank and be like, give me all your money.
I hear that, and I'm like, did he have it in Mongolian currency? Like, when he came back to the U.S., did he have to go through customs and,
I need to change all the... Okay. Do you take change for a brick of heroin?
Okay, this is one of my least favorite parts about the movie right here. And, like, okay, I realize that he is the fucking Shadow. I realize that is his name, so I don't want to hear any smart-ass comments about that. Okay. Mainly talking to Philip. But when he's in this lit-ass ballroom, like, just...
Nowhere to hide,
just plain as day, and he's talking to the mayor or
Tim
whatever.
Tim Curry.
No, not Tim Curry. I'm talking about when he's talking to the police captain or whatever.
Okay.
Jonathan Winters.
Right. And Jonathan Winters is like, yeah, I'm having more problems with this Shadow character. And then all of a sudden, Alec Baldwin just leans back in his chair, and a just shadow comes over his entire body. And I'm like, where the fuck is that shadow coming from? Like, I don't care if he is the Shadow. There's nothing in this fucking room that presents a shadow that he can blend in with.
But, Steven, we don't know if he was clouding the guy's mind to make him think that he had shadows on him, or if he really had shadows on him.
I don't care if he was doing that. It looked shitty. It was just him, Steven, like, leaning back into a...
into nothing. Into the middle of this fucking brightly lit room. That,
that was him. He was getting ready to exercise his Jedi mind.
Right.
Like, you're not going to put a task force on that. That's not worth your time.
That's all he had to do.
It's just the terrible filmmakers letting us know he's doing mind tricks right now. Not to mention he could just do it, and then we would know because he just does whatever he wants.
His eyes glaze over every time he does it, though. No. Like, weird gray contact lens.
It's an opium, man.
Too long.
Brought it with him.
No, that's what I'm saying. It's like, okay, guys, this is where he presents that he's the Shadow. Everybody know he's the Shadow? Okay, guys, he's the Shadow.
Covered.
He's using Shadow powers now. Shadow powers now.
Shadow powers.
I think it's total bullshit that he can convince anyone of anything except for that he cannot convince them to not see his shadow. That's all. He can be invisible to them.
The Shadow is supposed to represent, like, the darkness that is still inside of him from his shitty days.
But to me, it represents the fact that he sucks as being a superhero.
He's not that good. He can never handle the dagger right. So, I mean, he can't even get that right.
He can't.
He's not good. I could go so far as to say he's terrible. He can't even handle henchmen that can just shoot arrows into his cape.
Or...
because they can see his shadow. It's like, oh, there's a light pointing at you. So there's a shadow on the wall, so now we know where you are. Okay, move out of the way of the light. Duck behind something.
Or easier than that, don't wear a cape.
Yeah.
then we have a smaller shadow.
That cape just seemed like it was a pain in the ass the entire movie. Like, didn't it? Then it just seemed like it was just fucking...
Yeah, and it was always getting caught.
Yeah.
It's like, if you're gonna catch a shadow, you're gonna catch him by his cape.
And even Tim Curry's like, oh...
yeah.
You're the Shadow, but all I have to do is shoot you with my gun.
Yeah, and I'm gonna...
I'm just a random scientist. I've shot a gun 4 times in my life.
And I'm gonna know where you are because we're in the submersion tank, and I'm gonna allow all the water to come in and see your fucking footprints sloshing through. I'm just gonna shoot where your footprints are.
Yeah. Okay, so let's explain more about the plot of this movie. What is going on?
What is the plot?
Yeah, that's kind of what I was getting at. Like,
Genghis fucking Khan is the plot. What is, like,
Genghis Khan's long-lost twin, or
his last remaining descendant.
His name is Shiwan.
Father's sister's cousin's former roommate.
Shiwan Khan.
Shiwan Khan.
So he ships himself to the United States.
In a magic box.
Because he couldn't possibly take in a fucking plane.
Nope.
Just a regular plane.
No, they would have been like, all right, looking at your papers here, you don't happen to be a descendant of Genghis Khan, do you?
He's like, no.
from Mongolia, your last name's Khan, and you kind of look like him.
Oh, and there's a button on your book bag that says, I want to take over the world.
Okay, we kind of, Westerners, they view Genghis Khan as, you know, a villain.
You just right. said Genghis Khan?
Genghis Khan.
Genghis Khan. It's
donkeys.
Okay, older, we uncle. View him as a villain.
Right.
Over there, they kind of loved him. He's like a folk hero.
Well, yeah. China didn't really love him.
China. Oh, no, not China. I'm talking about...
Goddamn Mongolians! Neither did the... anybody.
Yeah, pretty basically, much anybody that he invaded.
Basically anybody, like, like the height of the Islamic Empire in Iraq at, though, was just torched because of Genghis Khan.
There's no way. He only has one living descendant. No fucking way.
Well, yeah, Mongolians were basically the Vikings of Asia.
Yeah, I was gonna say, he definitely banged his way through like, numbers of countries.
They didn't kill everybody. It's like, basically, if they ransack your village, you got a chance to join.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, we can either kill you all, or you can join, and you can be one of us, and you'll have the good life. And it's like, well, you know what? That seems pretty reasonable.
Basically the Dothraki from Game of Thrones.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's who they're based on.
So there's no way he's the last living descendant, because that would mean that everyone in Mongolia is dead.
Which we know isn't true, because there was the whole setup scene at the beginning.
Yeah.
There's at least 12 or 14 people left in Mongolia.
Yeah, there's at least a dozen
and they're
extras.
All high as shit.
And they're all fucking smoking.
We didn't talk about Ian McKellen. He's in this movie.
Yeah, I saw him and I was like, what?
Yeah, he's the doctor who is, the father of the love interest?
Yes.
Yep. Who is a natural telepath also.
Yeah.
Yeah, she didn't have to be trained in Mongolia by a monk. She just got it.
Ian McKellen's one of those guys that is pretty good in everything, but I thought that he fell a little short in this because he really didn't say
he's
shit.
He's barely in the movie.
Yeah.
He's just good at being himself. I feel like he plays himself in a lot of movies. Like as Magneto, I'm like, other than the hatred for a lot of things, he seems like he's just pretty natural.
I think it's kind of funny that he played somebody that was abused by the Nazis, but then in Apt Pupil, he was a Nazi.
Apt Pupil. Haven't seen it.
Well, because, you know, if you're going to be in Hollywood, you're probably going to be on one of those two sides eventually, because
we're
Nazis
possibly
are in all
sides. Yes. Yes, yes.
And then Phillip's Nightmare Fuel was in this movie also.
Oh, yeah? Oh, I forgot. Centipede?
No,
Tim Curry.
Oh, yeah.
That's the other Nightmare Fuel. Philip has a range of Nightmare Fuel.
Well,
and like,
Tim Curry is at the very top of the list.
So, like, what if it was a centipede with Tim Curry's face?
Well, I mean...
And centipede pinchers.
Why, though? Like, why would you do that?
It's like, right now it's going through his brain like, yep, stored in for later. As soon as I close my eyes.
It's like, tonight. You know how I stopped having night terrors after I turned 15? Yeah, that's back now.
So, who's Tim Curry's character? I'm trying to remember what
he was the other scientist. He's a jealous scientist.
That's right.
Yeah. So, which would mean, of course, he's good at shooting a gun and pretty much almost killing the Shadow.
Shmangus Khan. Yeah, he locks him in.
Shmangus Khan.
Yeah.
Shmangus Khan, yeah.
Ooh. What a gross Khan.
Ooh.
He locks him in that submersion tank and...
His plot is to hit Shmangus Khan. He's gonna make is basically the equivalent of an atomic bomb, and he is going to use it to threaten New York and be like, hey, I'm going to blow you up if you don't give me a bunch of money, knowing they're not going to do it, and just blow them up anyway.
Yeah. Bronzium is the element that is supposed to be so explosive. You know,
is that anything real?
No.
I didn't think so. No,
not even at all.
Let's take...
Bronze and uranium.
Yeah.
Which I think it is like some kind of byproduct of uranium they're using as fuel for their weapon.
God damn it. It's like hydrium. Or helium.
Yeah, plutonogen. Plutonogen.
Plutonogen. Yeah, see, now that you made up that word, it's going to be used in the next terrible movie.
Plutonogen.
Fucking Ghost Shark 4.
Raidonston.
Yeah.
Or Raidonston.
Yeah. So that's... Dumb. You know, he hides the explosives inside of a hidden building, which apparently he bought with his mad...
drug money.
His mad Genghis Khan money.
His Magnolian Skrillex.
Magnolian?
Well, you have to buy it. You can just say whoever owns it, you control your mind.
Little known fact, Genghis Khan set up a trust fund for all of his descendants.
Compound interest.
Right, can
fucking
we just
compound
interest.
Yes, the compound interest.
This is so shitty.
Oh my god, that is the best pun.
The worst pun ever.
So, can we just like stop for a second and just figure out how fucking stupid this entire storyline is?
It's awful. He cloaks an entire building in the middle of Manhattan or New York City.
It's so dumb.
Oh my god,
it's the very worst.
Okay, if he apparently hypnotized everyone in New York City
to not seeing that building.
There's why doesn't he just travel the city to city, you know, meeting with world leaders, hypnotizing them, and then you don't have to blow anything up?
Yeah, you don't even know you fucking exist, so there won't be anyone wanting to kill you, or knowing that you're going to fucking threaten to kill them.
Why did he kill the guy?
There's plenty of plot holes here. I mean, first of all, Shmengis Khan has that ability to like
Shmengis
hypnotize
Khan.
People.
Fucking Shmengis.
So does the Shadow. He can hypnotize whoever he wants.
We ran out of names. You're Shmengis.
Well, he's the last descendant. All the other variations.
He got the
that
shitty end of the gene pool.
Nah, Shmengis. Yeah, you.
Dengus Kong.
Why did he kill the guy
Khan
on top of the Empire State Building? He doesn't directly kill him. He mind controls him into jumping off of the Empire State Building, but the guy has the presence of mind enough to say, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm out here. Somebody help me. And then he jumps off of the Empire State
Titanic
Building. Yeah. He bounces down the fucking Empire State Building, which the very next scene, it cuts to Alec Baldwin in the streets. He's like talking to somebody, and in the background you see a shadow
a dot
falling from the Empire State Building, and it hits a tier on the Empire State Building, and you hear a and then he bounces off of that tier and falls down to another tier, and you hear another
No.
You hear it instantly on Alec Baldwin's level on the street. He's literally probably a mile away. Seriously, sound is not instantly there. And two, why? Sound?
No.
He's going, ow. Like,
he's fucking Will Ferrell from Austin Powers.
Yeah.
I've broken my legs very badly. I'm on fire. And my skin is
all a little bit like almonds.
Seriously, go
back
and watch that.
I'm hurting very
bad. And it's like,
he falls so far. And somehow,
it's the fucking Empire State Building. Yeah. Like, no chance in hell.
Yeah.
Ugh. So
and there would have been no second screen.
No. There wouldn't have, yeah. Let alone that there wouldn't have been a first. He wouldn't have bounced.
He wouldn't have had a head to scream.
Yeah.
His head would have just, yeah.
Okay, what if he hit it with his body and his head popped off, but there's still like some vocal cords dangling? Maybe you get like a last,
No.
So they invade the Invisible Tower, which is just an old abandoned hotel that he, you know,
we've skipped the entire movie, but fine.
Don't care. I do not care. Because the fucking...
What else is there to talk about? It's terrible. It's very terrible.
Did he erase the zoning records at City Hall that says there's a fucking giant hotel here?
Not only did he erase everyone's memory that they're... It's like, well, there used to be one in here. I don't know what happened.
They blew it up, but
they see it as a vacant lot.
They erased all the records. As like they went to a lot of trouble for this very... It's not even like a really
impressive
thing.
Why couldn't he set up a place outside of town? Seriously.
Well, he was planning on detonating the bomb from there, but we brought up a better point. Why not just use his obvious, overwhelming hypnotizing power and just do any other thing with it? Anything else?
I feel like there's so many things he could have done with
he could have done the whole Power Rangers Leap to Our Doom thing and just been like, everybody just go walk into the ocean right now. Jump in the Hudson River. Everyone
it's dark for a Power Rangers.
One thing about this movie that I feel like definitely happened was the writer for the script, you know, nailed out like half of a fucking script and handed it to the director or whatever, and he looked through it and everything was, and then the writer was like, well, I'm not finished with it yet. I still have to explain all this shit. And the director was just like, just make it up as you go. It's cool.
We got this.
Alec Baldwin's on board. He already signed the contract. So literally, do what you think is okay. Like, connect the dots in a loose fashion.
Yes.
Fill it in.
Memory erasing.
With some pretty good CG for 94.
Depending on what you're talking about, I guess. Like, the,
some of
the knife.
The knife was terrible.
Yeah.
The knife was terrible.
But he eventually does mind meld with it at the very end.
Oh, as it's at his throat, and he's like, this is a perfect time to relax. This is how I'm going
to
control
it. The only time he ever manages to do it is whenever it's very much wanting to cut his head off.
Yeah. He does pretty brutally kill the villain, though.
Yeah, he throws a glass shard through his forehead.
He doesn't fucking kill him. He stabs him in the brain, but he's fine. He just has to remove that part of his brain.
Yeah, and revealed that the doctor that did the removing of the part of the brain is one of his, the Shadow
Recruits.
Right,
one of his recruits. He's
makes
got
sure
ring
to
on.
Neutralize him as much as possible.
Oh, yeah, we forgot to mention that when he saves somebody, they owe him a life debt, and they get a special ring, and they become part of his secret
that's
society.
Actually the only good part about the movie. Like, that's kind of a fun, like, little gimmick, like, to me, at least. I think that's like, oh, well, yeah, maybe they might be like, well, I do kind of owe him. They were going to murder me with these iron, or these cement boots.
Yeah, cement shoes, buddy.
But
he shoots off of him. Two giant fucking pistols, he shoots off of him, and he's that good of the guy's totally relaxed laying there, too, just getting...
I really want to know if the people of this movie have ever seen somebody shoot concrete with bullets, like pistol bullets.
This was definitely...
These are special bullets, and he hypnotized the concrete.
It was no concrete. It was all in his mind.
Ah, yes.
In fact, he was never kidnapped.
Even, you know what?
Maybe he never left Mongolia.
He shot blind bullets.
Yes, yeah. It was like an odd couple. Like, he wakes up at the end, and he was just in an opium stupor.
He's like, man, that was a fucked up acid trip.
It's
like,
holy
hey,
shit.
Hey, this stuff. I want more of it.
Yeah, please. But sir, you were just laying on the ground seizing and stuff was coming out of your mouth.
Shut up, give me it.
More. Another.
And a lot of blood out of all of your orifices. I think Jed Lee was here.
I was a lazy playboy in New York City and I had superpowers with my brain.
And they were like, yeah sure.
No,
you
whatever,
did. Some
Lamont.
Dinner.
Yeah, whatever, Lamont.
Yeah.
Sure.
No, dude. His actual powers were Meg Griffin's powers. All Family Guy. Yeah, dude.
My ability is the ability to be very ugly at will. So, yeah. Don't watch The Shadow.
For years, I thought whenever they... when he is the Shadow, he just has something over the bottom part of his face, and he has this giant honker of a nose.
Like an ascot. He has an ascot draped over his face.
For years, I thought that, that's one of his brothers standing in for him. But, apparently he's not.
No, it does, like...
It looks just like a...
Daniel.
Yeah, that's the one.
Daniel. Yeah, no.
Old fat head
Daniel
Baldwin.
Cranston.
Daniel
Cranston.
Oh, man.
Fat head Baldwin.
I don't remember. Did Tim Curry's character die?
Yeah. He kills him.
Oh, okay. Yeah, in that part where Tim Curry actually shoots the Shadow and he starts bleeding, all of a sudden there's, like, one speck of blood in the water.
Yeah.
And he hides under the waterfall.
And then that's it.
No more blood.
He magically heals.
Well, there's a lot of water.
And then
the blood
swims over
to water
to
ratio
hole.
Is a lot more.
It doesn't matter. You would still see fucking blood.
That's what you have to complain about, not the fact that it's like, I shot you, so I have confirmed, if this was Battleship, I can now shoot the rest of you to death.
Yeah.
Rather than just drowning you in my think tank for whatever reason.
Yeah.
I called it a think tank because he's a scientist.
Yeah,
and it's a tank.
I get it.
Yeah.
So clever. Oh, man. So...
Tim Curry was not scary in this movie.
Apparently there is a serial collection of The Shadow.
Oh, yeah.
From the 1940s.
Those are on Internet Archive if you want to go get those, but I wasn't interested, so I never...
Yeah,
For once, DeHart didn't watch a bunch of shit he didn't have to watch that was even way worse.
These both took place in the 30s, and both these movies are pretty reminiscent of The Phantom, which we also kind of talked about doing.
Yeah, but I think if we've watched these two, we can let ourselves off the hook at least for a while.
We've done enough shitty 1930s superheroes.
Yeah. No, we haven't. We need five more at least.
No. Please, no.
Oh, man.
Okay.
Can't wait to record tomorrow. That's going to be
so
fun.
So, I just have one piece of listener feedback.
Oh, just one?
Yep.
Every month, we want your feedback, even if you want to cover us with ghoul.
This is from our friend Cameron, who is a constant...
Cobra Camerahead.
Yeah. Our constant, she was a constant feedbacker.
Oh, yeah.
So.
She's an avid listener, which we could not possibly be more grateful to have one.
Yeah. She said on Facebook, "Hey guys, I usually tweet you, but I needed more than 140 characters. First, great episode tribute to Robin Williams. Second, thank you for your comments about those who judge mental illness and people who commit suicide. As someone whose life has been touched by that type of tragedy, I really appreciate what you said. Keep up the awesome work, guys. Your podcast is always a much-needed laugh after a long day of teaching high schoolers. You guys kick ass. Thank you very much. That's awesome.
I would love it if your high schoolers listen to us. I do somewhat
not,
inappropriate for high school age children.
I do not envy having to teach high schoolers.
Yeah.
I was a sub briefly. And it is awful.
Briefly.
After a long day of just hearing teenagers bitch at one another.
Yeah. Come in here and hear us bitch at one another.
Because we're pretty much just teenagers.
Steven's not a teenager. He doesn't, not nearly that much. Seven, at most seven.
So, I'm seven, you're about 15,
yeah,
DeHart's 103.
Yeah.
103 teenagers?
Yeah.
So, yeah, R.I.P. Richard Attenborough, and
oh, yeah,
I hope
man.
They spare no expense on your funeral.
Yeah.
I don't think, I'm sure they didn't. What if that was just his whole eulogy? Spared no expense.
It's basically his script from Jurassic Park.
He said other stuff in the movie.
He said like five things and then always ended it with a, oh, but spared no expense. Even when they're leaving, he says that.
Well, he wants you to know that it's all very expensive.
Yeah.
He's like, trust me, I'm old. I know what expensive things are.
Yep.
But yeah, how old was he? Like 2000?
He was 90.
Yeah,
he lived a pretty long life.
Yep.
Okay, well, Ben. Thank you.
It's been awesome having you.
Thanks for having me. Hope you
had
a lot of fun.
Thanks for coming and showing up to the podcast.
Hey, I get it. Coming like jizz. So, back row hecklers, if you're into wrestling, which we often get around to talking about on here.
Mostly because wrestlers are in really bad movies.
Yeah, and also they're really awesome at fucking smashing people's spines, which is really great to watch. That we love to do.
Yeah. Check out a couple other podcasts that are friends of ours, Return to Living Podcasts, who do a lot of horror and haunt-based things, and then our friends over at Nerdonomy, who do Nerds on Film and Nerds on History. And then if you want to tell your friends about us, all of our episodes are available for download on iTunes for absolutely free. You don't have to pay for shit. And also, you can get them on Unitedcypher.com, where you can find Talks Over Games and Unitedcypher Presents.
Yay.
And I really wish you guys would record another episode of Unitedcypher Presents.
Well, you know, we hate sticking to formats, and we're trying to think of something new to do.
Oh, I see.
Because
you guys are too...
We've been podcasting since, like...
1992?
Well, no, we've been podcasting...
Before
like,
iPods existed. I know this for sure.
Yeah.
It's like 9 years.
Yeah.
No, yeah.
Because
longer than that, I'm pretty sure.
Well, 10 years... Well, we've been doing stuff on the web for 10 years.
Yeah.
The first year and a half, it was a streaming show.
Well, I was just looking at Time Hop yesterday, and it said 1 year ago today was our 100th episode, and we are on our 6th year of being Motion Picture Meltdown.
That is fucking crazy.
Yep.
So, ever since Steven texted me one day and said, we really need to start doing a podcast about horror movies, and then I made a really bad graphic that I will not share, and came up with the
badass
name.
I will share it, and underneath I will put, Philip Collins did this, and put his address and phone number.
Yeah, thanks. I'm not sharing it because I can actually make good graphics now. And then I just called him up one day, I was like, yeah, we're doing a podcast, that's what this is right now. So let's do it.
So,
we did it.
Naked. So,
Cheese was actually there for the inaugural episode, too.
He was. Which, we need to get him back on the fucking show, because every once in a while he says one funny thing. I remember the last episode he was on, he said something about his head bleeding. So, I was down for it.
Yeah, that's pretty funny.
So, if you do want to follow us on Twitter and send us some listener feedback, you can do so at MPM Podcast, or you can also do so on UnitedCypher.com or through Facebook. So, hit us up on there. And with that being said, we'll see you next week to continue our Superhero September. Or, I guess, not so Superhero September.
Yeah, our Shitty Hero September.
And I'm one of your hosts, Stephen the Roast Rosenberg. And Ben, I want to thank you again.
Yeah.
So
thanks for having me.
Yeah. We gotta get you on here again.
High five sound effect.
Yeah. Woo! You can't high five yourself.
You said sound effect, and you both did it. What?
And we'll see you next time.
Touchdown brings me round again to find I'm not the man they think I am at home. Oh no, 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 I'm a rocket man. Rocket
Yeah.